Bună ziua din nou și bine ați revenit și vă mulțumesc că ați revenit din pauză, așa curând. Avem o sesiune importantă, o sesiune în exclusivitate. Machen România lansează în exclusivitate în România la zilele Bizi un studiu despre trendurile globale și am să vă rog să fiți receptivi și să puneți întrebări și să o primim în aplauze pe Diana Ceaușu, Machen București. Bine ai venit, Diana!
Bună ziua tuturor! Nu-mi place să vorbesc la microfon, dar o să mă stăluiesc. Mă bucur foarte mult că sunteți alături de noi, pentru că noi, ca și Machen București, ne-am dorit foarte tare să aducem în prim plan, în ziua inovației, studiul global despre Global Trends. Motivul pentru care ne-am entuziasmat foarte tare este foarte simplu. Și anume, pleacă de la faptul că în lumea de astăzi, transparentă cum o știm, orice faci ca și brand oriunde în lume, dacă ești brand global sau local, are un impact care se resimte în orice altă piață din lumea asta. Mai mult decât atâta, oricât am fi de branduri locale sau branduri globale care activează pe piața locală, atunci când vine vorba de benchmark de inovație, suntem mai conectați decât oricând la ce se întâmplă în restul lumii. Ne entuziasmăm când nu știu ce brand a făcut ceva în China sau ceva în Australia, care, by the way, merge foarte bine aplicat și în România, într-un mod chiar mai interesant și mai inovativ. Așa că ne-a plăcut foarte mult inițiativa Machen World Group de a crea cel mai amplu studiu de cercetare a relației dintre oameni, globalitate și branduri în ziua de astăzi, la nivel global. Este un studiu care s-a făcut în 30 de piețe din toată lumea, combinând cercetarea cantitativă cu o grămadă de metode antropologice, de la etnografii, la interviuri în profunzime cu factori de influență culturală. Și pentru că am vrut ca acest studiu să aibă aplicabilitate și în România, majoritatea finding-urilor se regăsesc și în varianta de cercetare pe care am făcut-o pe piața locală. Așa că ce vom descoperi împreună astăzi nu este doar ceea ce cred oamenii din ziua de azi despre brandurile globale și despre globalitate, ci este și ceea ce simt românii față de globalitate și brandurile globale. Structura va fi următoarea. O să începem cu o foarte interesantă prezentare din partea lui Claudiu Pândaru, care va încerca să contextualizeze, mai ales că știm cu toții, trecem printr-o perioadă foarte interesantă în România, din punctul de vedere al oamenilor și a schimbărilor prin care trec oamenii. Vor urma Arjo Singh și Ronnie Collins, pe care îi voi introduce puțin mai târziu, să vorbească despre rezultatele studiului global. Iar la sfârșit vom avea o discuție în care vom încerca să înțelegem ce putem aplica din aceste rezultate pentru a crea inovație. Acestea fiind spuse, îl invit pe Claudiu Pândaru, care nu cred că mai are nevoie de introducere. El este unul dintre cei mai cunoscuți jurnaliști de business și economie din România. Mulțumesc!
Mulțumesc! Nu e așa? Primul rând, îi mulțumesc Diana pentru că mi-a lăsat provocarea asta să vorbesc înaintea unui studiu despre brandurile globale și comportamentul brandurilor globale. Sunt niște cifre interesante, eu am văzut studiul ca să vedeți. Vreau să vorbesc despre altceva. Am să vorbesc despre ce s-a întâmplat în aceste zile în România. Și pentru că, cu siguranță, la timp, știu toți cine sunt, trebuie să ce s-a întâmplat în România în ultimele câteva săptămâni? Vizibil. Pentru că, dincolo de percepție și de ce am văzut în stradă, mulți dintre cei care sunt în sală, poate s-au și dus și au văzut ce s-a întâmplat, sunt câteva întrebări și fenomene care nu sunt legate numai de România. Forțele care i-au scos pe acei oameni în stradă și motivele. Deci prima întrebare ar fi ce a reușit să scoate în stradă 30.000 de oameni. Prima, a doua zi de proteste, cam atâți oameni au fost în stradă, așa, în medie. E clar că factorul declanșator, focul ăla în care au venit niște oameni și din cauza care au venit niște oameni, a readus în prim am toate nemulțumirile unei generații, unei generații și să nu privim această generație numai din perspectiva vârstei, pentru că ar fi greșit. În stradă. Dar nu numai atât. Și pentru ca să înțelegem mai bine de ce au ieșit acei oameni în stradă, ar trebui să ne uităm întâi la cine sunt oamenii. Cine sunt oamenii? Am fost în viață, m-am uitat cu atenție, mi-am întâlnit și mulți prieteni, fac și o mică paranteză. M-am și lovit de câțiva șefi de agenții care îmi spuneau, agenții de publicitate, care îmi spuneau că mai sunt și alți colegi. Era un fel de golden crown acolo, fiecare venise cu mesaje inovative. Pentru că fac parte din generația asta despre care vorbim. E o generație pe care o știu cei care advertising, o știu și cei care conduc sau stabilesc strategii pentru branduri, fiindcă se uită în prezentări și se raportează la această generație atunci când își găsesc până să îi gândesc mesajele de marketing sau de vânzări. Vă invit să ne uităm și să ne vedem și fețele, pentru că e important. Generația asta e o generație care, da, nu mai știu, și mască pe față. Sunt oameni care au diferite profesii. Sunt oameni care obișnuiesc să consume tot felul de produse, dar o fac. Sunt cei care de obicei stabilesc tendințele, atât în consum, și nu numai în consumul de bunuri sau servicii, și în consumul de media. Pe mine, în primul rând, asta mă interesează. Și au venit cu mesaje. Te uiți la mesajele pe care ei le-au adus în viață și poți să-ți faci așa o idee despre agenda acelor oameni sau dorințele oamenilor. Unii îi îndeamnă pe oameni să ceară ajutor. Aveți curaj, haideți să fim alături de medici. Alții pur și simplu fac apel la acea tragedie de la Pitul Colectiv și scriu pe un panou că nu avem voie să uităm. Sunt și oameni care se uită direct către guvern sau bord, da? Și inventează tot felul de mesaje creative. Am văzut multă creativitate în piață în zilele astea. Însă, dacă le iei pe toate și le subsumezi unui singur, încerci să le pui sub o singură umbrelă, probabil că normalitatea este cuvântul și dorința principală a celor care au ieșit în stradă și a celor care au stat acasă. Sunt foarte mulți care au stat acasă, în alte orașe, dar își doresc același lucru. Normalitate. Corupție fără corupție. Un sistem în care cetățean să fie respectat când își plătește taxe. Un sistem medical în care să nu-ți faci griji că te duci pentru a-ți rezolva o situație medicală și pleci cu altă problemă de sănătate. Sunt 30.000 de oameni care reprezintă o majoritate. În general, când uităm pe cifre la acel grup social care se adresează atât brandurile, cât și mesajele de publicitate, dar și noi, media, avem senzația că e o nișă, că e foarte mic acel grup. Nu cred că mai este atât de mic. Cred că a devenit o majoritate. Majoritate care oricum dictează și consumul și tendințe în societate. Am să vă dau un exemplu personal. Mă raportez la niște cifre personale, nu s-a terminat piață și nici toată această mișcare și atunci primele cifre pe care le am sunt unele extrem de personale, mă uit însă cu atenție la ele, de pe contul meu de Facebook. Am câteva postări care au ajuns la 4 milioane de oameni. Postări pe Facebook. Like-ul și share-ul. Nu îndemnam pe nimeni să facă nimic, ci pur și simplu relatam ce se întâmplă în piață. Și atunci pot trage concluzia că erau extrem de mulți oameni care nu erau prezenți acolo, dar simpatizau cu dorința aceea de mișcare. Am mai făcut niște mici experimente jurnalistice și am făcut niște live stream-uri pe Facebook din piață, dintr-o aplicație Facebook Mentions, în fine, de discutat, dar cu altă ocazie despre ea, o aplicație și un live stream care a adus 14.000 de oameni care se uitau în același timp la ce se întâmplă în piață. Vă imaginați, eu cu un rucsac pe spate și un telefon care filma haotic, așa, oamenii din mulțime sau ce se întâmplă acolo. 14.000 de oameni. Raportați-o la un timp de rating TV, rezultate și pe urmă luați în considerare și faptul că punctul de rating este rezultatul unei estimări sociologice. Aici vorbim despre oameni numărați în par, fiecare. Concluzia e simplă. În media se schimbă, asta e prima concluzie pentru mine și pentru noi ca ziariști. Canalele de comunicare evoluează, agenda media se schimbă și dictată de felul în care este consumat acest tip de conținut, dar și felul în care media interpretează și schimbă, se transmite. Am dat exemplu de personal, pe telefon și la exterior din piață. Asta nu înseamnă că media tradițională nu contează. Contează extrem de mult. Credibilitatea însă și relevanța sunt cele care pot face diferența și acolo. Da. Pe lângă aceste constatări personale, niște cifre brute, mai sunt și alte lucruri de remarcat. Nu se schimbă numai media și felul în care se transmit informații. Se mai schimbă ce? Sau ar trebui să se schimbe? Pentru că altfel întotdeauna va exista această prăpastie între, cum a fost cazul de față, autoritate și societate. Felul în care este exercitată democrația. În momentul de față, eu ar trebui să explic unui copil, da? Care la câțiva ani, poate nici nu știe să vorbească foarte bine de scris, nici măcar, dar cu siguranță știe să vorbească și eventual să se și joace pe fundaciul ecranului, ar trebui să explicăm acestui copil că el, când va face 18 ani, se va duce aproape de casă la o secție de vot, o să pună o ștampilă de lemn pe o hârtie în dreptul urmărilor, o să împăturească hârtia și să se ducă să o bage într-un punctul de carton. Condiția în care el de acum, de la câțiva anișori, deschide tableta. Democrația participativă va evolua altfel, sau trebuie să evolueze. Altfel, această prăpastie între cei care sunt consultați și cei care iau pe urmă rezultatul consultării, se va adânci. Democrația participativă trebuie să fie una în timp real. Nu mai poți să stai la 4 sau la 5 ani și să aștepți un feedback din partea societății, pentru că este prea lent. Oamenii se vor simți neconsultați. Vor simți că direcția pe care ei o văd pentru acea societate nu e cea pe care o pun în practică decidenții și vorbim de o societate care stă bine din punct de vedere al leadership-ului autorității. În România mai avem multe de în zona asta. Un site interesant a apărut în zilele manifestației în care erau invitați atât cei din piață, dar nu numai, oricine, să rancheze revendicările. Succesul acestui site cred că demonstrează că ceea ce spun e valabil. Oamenii au nevoie de o consultare continuă. În caz contrar, și zis, propastia se va atinge. Pentru că, și asta am pus în prezentarea asta, criza democrației nu ține mai de valorile cum se dezbate. Corupția, felul în care sunt gestionate anumite sisteme, cum se investesc banii, cum se câștigă contracte cu statul, cum se implementează informatizarea diferitelor sisteme, ține și de modalitatea în care sunt puse în dezbatere. Asta este ceea ce urmează să se schimbe. Altfel, vom vedea proteste, precum cele din aceste zile, tot timpul. Chiar dacă nu o să mai avem un factor declanșator sau un catalizator, cum a fost tragedia aceea din grupul colectiv. Și asta nu se întâmplă în România, numai în România. Vedem tot felul de mișcări, unele denumite Occupy sau de altă natură, dar în acea zonă, denumite la pachet în felul ăsta, în care sunt catalogați cei care participă drept anarhiști, oameni care își doresc haosul, nu înlocuirea oamenilor din sistem, ci dărâmarea totală a sistemului, cred că trebuie să ne uităm punctual la fiecare parte. Unele nu sunt așa. Unele vin tocmai din această prăpastie, dintre felul în care este consultată societatea și populația. Și atunci, întrebările care pot funcționa și ca o mică concluzie a ceea ce eu am observat personal, nu am imagine sau că doar asta e direcția de dezbatere și de discuție, ar fi asta. Trăim în secolul cloudului și al putem de procesare. Și totuși noi trebuie să ne învățăm copiii sau pe noi înșine că votăm odată la 4-5 ani cu o ștampilă de lemn. Este o prăpastie majoră între cum știm noi că poate fi exercitată o consultare, fie ea și cu autoritatea, și felul în care este, în realitate, ea exercitată. Ștampilă și formă de lemn. Pe urmă, liderul trebuie să aibă legitimitate. Alegerile, de obicei, conferă oricărui lider această legitimitate. Întrebarea mea e suficient însă ca legitimitatea să vină doar odată la 4 sau 5 ani? Nu ar trebui gândit un sistem prin care permanent atât liderul, dar mai ales deciziile lui, să primească legitimitatea din partea celor care, pe urmă, beneficiază sau din potrivă de acea decizie? Și ultima întrebare și poate cea mai grea atunci când vine vorba despre datul răspuns, este cum va decide nu la aceste liberalizări a pentru că despre asta trăim într-o era a rețelei sociale, ne ghidăm de multe ori chiar și acțiuni, probabil și sală. Cei care au pe bună destină în Ucraina fac asta. Se ghidează după feedback-ul primit pe rețele sociale. Putem să ne gândim că, într-o anumită perioadă de timp, aceeași reacție și aceeași consultare o vor folosi și cei din structurile guvernamentale sau din cadrul autorității ca sintagmă în general? Probabil că da, pentru că altfel, iarăși, prăpastia se va duce. Oamenii care sunt obișnuiți să-și consulte la job cifrele din real time, iar în cadrul prietenilor, să primească feedback real asupra acțiunilor lor de zi cu zi, se vor simți neconsultați. Vor simți totdeauna că liderul nu se raportează atunci când iau o decizie la părerea lor. Și vor simți o frustrare continuă știind că există tehnologie, posibilitatea ca acest lucru să fie făcut. Cum va fi pus în practică și dacă va fi pus în practică, nu știu să vă răspund. E o dezbatere extrem de lungă. Sunt și multe pericole. Relevanța feedback-ului, felul în care este ea calculată și strânsă. Sunt foarte multe pericole. Dar sunt niște întrebări la care statul ca entitate trebuie să dea niște răspunsuri. Pentru că altfel lucrurile nu vor merge bine. Luând această mică și pe genunchi teorie a schimbării sistemului, cred că ea poate fi aplicată și la nivel personal, dar și la nivel de industrie. Lucrurile nu stau pe loc. Feedback-ul ăla sau felul în care noi ne organizăm strategiile, eu în media, voi fiecare în jobul vostru, trebuie să plece și de la astfel de considerări. Și închei prezentarea. Timpul este limitat. Vă mulțumesc în primul rând pentru atenție și o ultima imagine, tot din viață, care ilustrează concluzia asta finală și legătura cu studiul prezentat astăzi. Vă mulțumesc!
Mulțumim foarte mult, Claudiu! I will switch to English now, and I will invite in here Harjo Singh, who is Executive Vice President of McKinney Europe and the Regional Head of Strategy, that together with Rodney Collins, the head of Truth Central, McKinney Europe's group, biggest data intelligence unit, will present the findings that Truth About Global Brands showed us about the relationship between people, brands, and globality.
Speak without a microphone. Tell me if it works. Can you hear me? Yeah. Good morning, everyone. Thank you so much for having us here. We're so excited to be here. And of course, we're going to say this at every conference. Oh, thank you. We're so excited. But we really are excited to be here, despite the super red room and all of that. I want to talk to you about, I know we've got a clock going on here, 29 minutes. But I want to take 5 minutes and talk to you about three things, just to kind of set the agenda for what you're going to hear and why we're excited for you to see it. First of all, it is humanly impossible for us to take this thing and present it to you in a half an hour. It took us 3 years to do this, and typically it takes about 2 hours. So you can just about imagine last night, as we're thinking about what do we pick and choose to make this interesting in about a half an hour. It's like sacrificing your own children. It's really hard. But we think we're onto something. So in the essence of managing expectations, I want you to take away from this just some provocations, perhaps some ideas, some things that make you go as, you know what, that's obvious. I kind of thought that was true, but it makes me think about it again. Or I never realized how much that's true and important today more than ever. So if you have those kinds of feelings, it's actually a good thing. On that note, I think it's important to know that we have a lot of data. As Diana already mentioned, my Romanian is not that good, but you know, I caught a few words, and as you can see, she was telling me. This is 29 countries, 30,000 people. It's our biggest study ever. And the reason we say biggest study ever, because as you know, Truth Central, which is our proprietary thought leadership unit, we've done about 18 studies, 18 global studies across the world. We've researched everything from women to moms to technology to privacy to all kinds of conversations that are going on there that have a direct or an indirect imperative on how brands need to act, behave, and conduct themselves in today's world. So anything that affects that, we go and research, we build a point of view on that. So it is no surprise that we would have a point of view on global brands and on brands, how they need to navigate this world of globality where so much has changed. And if you were to sum it all up, we like to say, this is a crazy time because it's for the first time in our history. It's just as important to be known for what we mean as it is to be known for what we make. And that is symptomatic of Claudio's talk about how much we need to be able to give things that are truly relevant, truly meaningful, truly engaging, with a sense of immediacy and a sense of honesty that hasn't existed before, because the power doesn't lie with marketers and brands anymore. People have the power. People talk to everyone. The media landscape has completely changed. So the rules have changed, and we need to have an understanding of this new global world. And that is what prompted us to do the study. The other thing that prompted us to do the study, and it's always good to tell a bit of a story, so you kind of know why did these guys go around doing this in 30 countries, was that someone asked our president, Luca Littner, global client, hey, do you guys have a point of view on how brands should navigate this world of globality today, as it stands today? And we're like, oh yeah, I'm sure we do have one. We're 23,000 people with offices in 180 countries. We work on some of the world's most successful global brands. And at the same time, 50% of our business in all our markets is local. So yeah, we have a great understanding of what works locally, what works globally. We should be able to get it to you. And we realized that we didn't really have a current perspective on it. So we looked at all the existing perspectives that were out there, whether they're from research companies or marketing companies or thought leaders, and we realized that nothing was really, really current. Either things were too academic, or things were too esoteric, or just not meaningful and clear. Just too many new principles came up. So we actually felt that it was important for us to do this and do it right. So that's the story behind what we've done. The third point that I wanted to talk about is what did we learn from it? Rodney's going to talk to you about the key findings and collapse them in about 25 minutes and 36 seconds. But what you're going to see over there is that the principles of navigating in this world of globality, you will realize, are quite simple, but at the same time fraught with complexity. And you need a very sophisticated understanding, therefore. So what happens is, it's completely changed this idea of invade and scale. How many of us have been in the business longer than 10 years? Right? Everyone in this room. And we all know globalization. Come up with an idea, go into a market, say I was here first, and then boom, 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 scale, 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 produce, 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 make 1,000 TV ads, adapt the language, and we're global. That's completely changed. So the idea has become that you need a different label. You can see that three great principles that we will touch upon how do you calibrate your globality. What are the imperatives for the category that you operate in? What are the imperatives for the consumer? And what do you have to do by way of being meaningful and useful to people? My last point on that is, why are we excited to talk to you about this on an innovation day? Innovation day, right? We call it innovation day. We've all been in the business long enough to know that innovation days are grossly misunderstood because innovation can mean many things to many people. So I actually have to read this now because yesterday we had this idea. I said, you know what? Let's just look at the dictionary meaning of innovation. And it makes everything clear. And it says, it's the process of translating an idea or an invention into a service that creates value, which people want to pay for. That's what innovation means in our world. And if you look at what is the basis of globalization and the meaning of globalization, it's about how will brands create value at scale in today's interconnected world. So you can immediately see the intersections, because what's common between the two is an understanding that's unique, bespoke, but is able to afford scale and has to be meaningful and useful. So we thought there were several intersections between innovation and globalization. We're going to explore some more of those in our panel. But for now, please join me in welcoming Rodney Collins to the stage. And before Rodney starts, everybody look into your goodie bags. We've got something really fun for you. You know, I had a career in telemarketing and shopping. So look into that. And this is a great quiz. And we urge you to take this quiz in your free time. Actually, take it while you're listening to Rodney, because he's only going to start getting interesting by the fifth slide. And you'll see, by the time we come to the end of this presentation, there's going to be something that this quiz will reveal about yourself and about what that will do for you. Helping you understand this world of globalization. So, thank you for that.
Bonus you up. This is my second time in Bucharest, and I've now learned two words, I guess. Was that correct? Is that okay? Okay, good. Thank you so much for having us. I'm really excited to share this study. I'm not going to take long to introduce myself or the project, as the project has done an excellent job doing so. So I'm going to just jump right in. As Harjit mentioned, this is a massive piece of research. So everything I share with you is very top line. We have so much data. We can really dig into this material and tell you lots of different stories about category, about markets, about audiences. But here, just take a quick look at the 30 markets that we did research in. And I say 30 because we've recently just completed research in Romania. So we now have findings for Romanians as well as these other 29 markets. In addition to this online survey, we also did qualitative research in 20 markets. We did consumer focus groups, we did in-home ethnographies, and we conducted interviews with the CMOs of global brands. Really interesting findings there. But I want to talk to you about the face of consumer belief in the context of globalization. And really the first thing we notice is that the idea of globalization is very polarizing. I mean, I think that's pretty obvious, right? But when we walked into our consumer research groups, we had our consumers draw images of what they understood globalization to look like. And these are some of those images. You see a pretty beautiful world. People are holding hands, singing songs. Pharrell Williams is singing happy. The Beatles are saying, come together. It's a really beautiful world. But that's at the best. This world is one in which it's a dream of equality and fairness for all. In fact, in this world of globalization, the major force of creativity and innovation comes from that dynamic. So there's real positivity about the possibility of change and development in this context. On the other hand, we also see some pretty dark and sinister pictures of what globalization portends. You see that there's a lot of black crayon scribbling out the globe. You see also the role of brands up in the upper left-hand corner. Nike and Adidas are polluting the universe. And in fact, you see a lot of disunity. look at this very sad, broken heart up here, couples perhaps in divorce. This disturbing world is really about the fact that there's a sort of play of force, it's a power dynamic, in which people are disenfranchised or alienated from the possibility of improving their lives. And in fact, the Middle East has the greatest fear of what the threat of globalization holds for them. Europe is not too far behind. In fact, you can sort of see that Africa is the most enthusiastic about the possibility of globalization, but they are a rare outsider. So at the very worst, the word globalization seems to suggest a process that happens to you, not something that you participate in, but something that you are an operator or contributor to. I think what makes this dynamic really interesting, and Uber is a case which really sort of exposes that it's not as simple as that. It's not as simple as a single process happening to you. Of course, you all know that Uber is a really dynamic company that within 3 years went from one city and one market to 200 cities in 55 markets. That is an amazing amount of growth. And of course, we're offering the seamless connections. Last night, we were tempted to use Uber here in Romania. I mean, really excited that you can move from one country to another and immediately access that. But because this dynamic of globalization is so complex, we also know that Uber is facing intensive regulatory opposition in many of the markets it does business in. I don't know if any of you were at Cannes this year, but there was a protest from local taxi drivers against Uber, preventing many of our Cannes attendees from traveling from the airport to the festival. In London, the black cab drivers have actually stalled all of traffic in London, protesting the intrusion of Uber on a long tradition of black cab service. So it's really a dynamic world. I think what makes it really particularly dangerous in this kind of, you know, really hyper-fast, hyper-connected world is the fact that we are all sort of operating as global brands, even if you're a local brand. I want to talk about one cautionary tale about how even the best brands in this constantly dynamic world can get it wrong. So let's think about IKEA. Everyone's familiar with IKEA. Everyone's familiar with IKEA sort of offering this promise of democratizing style, and making the home a really wonderful place for everyone. So IKEA, in 2012, was thinking about expanding its operations in Saudi Arabia. And we all know that IKEA, the hallmark of their business model is that catalog that they offer you. So they were really thinking about how they might sort of translate and provide that catalog to the audience in Saudi Arabia. We weren't in the room, of course, when they were making these decisions, but they probably were having conversations around how can we do this efficiently? How can we do this at scale? What can we do to make this localized? And so, of course, they all realized, as we all know, that Saudi Arabia has really complex gender relations. So they're trying to figure out what they would do with this woman in this bathroom catalog spread. And so what do you think they did?
They took it out.
Very good. They just airbrushed the woman out, thinking that that was going to solve the problem. Of course, there was an immediate response, and this was a global response. Not a Saudi Arabian response, not a Swedish response, but a global response that lasted for 2 years. A conversation about Saudi Arabia, or IKEA's wrong choice. And they had to issue an official statement apologizing about the fact that they had violated their own company values and core mission. So what's really important about that is that every brand operates with a brand system. That catalog page, just like a menu item, just like a point of sale, just like that Facebook page, are all connected in a singular system. They're all touch points on one single system. And that system is undergirded by a mission. And that mission, you might call it a purpose, you might call it a reason to believe, should support every part of that system. Why that's particularly important, of course. We had a little bit of technical difficulty going from a Mac to a PC this morning. So we're gonna have to do this sort of in parts, this slide. So you'll have to kind of catch that back and forth, see it? So why that's particularly important is that 77% of our global population believe that global brands have the power greater than government to create positive change. I think this is really interesting in the context of cloud use commentaries this morning. I mean, this real belief that brands have the ability to do good. And in fact, 85% of our global consumers believe that global brands have the power to make positive change. Now, they don't only believe that they have the power to make change, but they also have suggested, 66% of them, that brands have already made the world better. This is how the markets in Russia, Europe line up. So Russia's the most pessimistic about this possibility of brands having greater power than governments. But look at that, three out of four people across Europe believe that global brands have greater power than government to create positive change. That's a really important statistic. There's a lot of opportunity for brands. And in fact, even more opportunity for global brands to have a really positive change. So all this is pointing to is the fact that this era of shallow globalization is dead. As Charjit mentioned earlier, the sort of thoughts that you might just sort of vacuum pack a single message, communicate it, and drop it into 30 markets and just see how it works, that era is over. We are an era of deep globality. This is what we're calling this stage. Something a little bit different than globalization, but it helps us to think about the fact that we're really thoughtfully enriching receiving cultures by communicating ideas, brands, movement in a multi-market capacity. And we're going to talk a little bit more about enriching the receiving culture a bit later. And as an anthropologist, I think that's really important. So here's the model. We're stepping away from this old world model in which it was exporting a single idea, pushing it onto a culture, ignoring what is locally nuanced or culturally sensitive, and really thinking about growth through market conquest. It was a one-way conversation at one point. Now we know that everything is part of a networked order. We're in constant conversation, and it really is about sort of mapping patterns. Patterns that might exist in surprising ways and places. And really ultimately thinking about what is the meaningful role that you'll have to enrich the receiving culture. So as we look at deep globality, we have three principles that support our belief in this practice of engaging in deep globality. First, you want to create a globality framework. Second, you want to earn your way into culture. And third, you want to inspire creative that travels. And I'm going to go very quickly through these three principles, but there's a lot more stuff that we can show you at another time. First, let's think about creating a globality framework. There are a lot of ways to structure an organization. These are all depictions of some of the global brands that we work with and the way that they function in terms of creativity and innovation and communications. Do you recognize your own company structure there? Maybe you have a different sketch of how your company business operates. These are all different models that we work with. Of course, there's something very interesting about those models. There is always a tension between being too centralized or being too decentralized. So we really want to find a way to help you steal the pendulum and find freedom within a certain framework. So we have this very interesting technological collaborator. It's a lot like a stereo tuner, where you dial up or dial down each of these different factors. So first, we have category. This is really thinking about how global or local the preferences or expectations of your category are. Next, we have markets. This is really thinking about how different markets respond to and trust in terms of loyalty, in terms of commitments to global versus local brands. We have audience. This is really thinking about the attitudes and mindsets of your audience in different markets and the receptivity that they have towards globality or global brands. And then we have regulatory environments. I'm sure many of you think about this on a daily basis. And some of these are very much more open to globality as opposed to being much more insular or protected. And then, of course, the internal dynamics. How do ideas move around your organization or your company? Today, I'm just going to talk about two of those dials, category and audience. And we can talk with you at a later date about the others. So let's look at category quickly. One of the things that we noticed that was really interesting about category, and this is going to be very intuitive to you, is that there's a strong preference for food and beverage categories to be local. This is a global preference. So that's, you can see the numbers there. 76% of our global population prefers local brands rather than global brands when it comes to food and beverage. But in the reverse, sort of antithetical to that, when it comes to technology, 76% of our global consumers prefer global brands when it comes to technology as opposed to local brands. So there's some interesting divides there. But what's really interesting and what makes this a little bit more complex is that when you look at specific markets, category preferences are wildly different. So when you look at a country like Germany, so this is their preference to buy global brands, look at that. All across the board, they prefer local brands in every category, vis-a-vis the global index, the global average, right? So largely leaning local in Germany. But then if you look like at a market like Turkey, you see that in almost every category, they prefer global brands over local brands. So this really suggests something interesting about the ability for your category to perform in a particular market in terms of that relationship or preference between global and local brands. Next, we're going to talk about audience. So you have your quizzes. Did you take your quiz? Anybody do the quiz? Not enough time yet to do the quiz? Well, I'll tell you about the quiz. I could probably guess what many of you are, but I won't do it, not to embarrass myself. So this segmentation is something we developed through cluster analysis. We looked at all of the attitudes that our consumers have towards global media culture, film, television, literature, sports. We looked at their frequency of travel, the number of languages that they speak. And then we also looked at their attitudes, preferences, usage of global versus local brands, and we developed the segmentation. On that far side of the slide, we have the armchair globalists. These are the individuals who are most optimistic about this era of deep globality. They're really interested in the possibility of global brands providing change and opportunity for them. They're really interested in global media culture. But the one thing that holds them back from being true globalists is money. They don't travel very much. They tend to be millennials, younger generation. So they're sort of stuck in their armchairs, admiring this world of globality. Then we have the extreme globalists. That's our smallest segmentation. These are people who travel extensively. They're really excited about everything global. They wouldn't think twice about having a sort of dinner in Tokyo, and then breakfast in New York, and then lunch in Rome. They're very excited about this possibility of really exploring the global landscape. And they're also excited about global brands. Next, we have the professional globalist. I bet many people in this room are professional globalists, possibly traveling quite a bit for work. You're probably having a pretty decent understanding and appreciation of global brands, but maybe liking local brands a little bit more than our other globalists, but also being pretty excited about global media culture. Then we have the staunch localists. These are people who are pretty resistant against global culture, not interested in global media, not excited about global brands, and pretty much not travelers. Then we have the reluctant globalists. They're pretty ambiguous about global brands. They might have them in their lives. Global media culture, a little bit. But they're not particularly excited about the roles of either in their lives. Pretty ambiguous group. Of course, these over-index in certain markets. We have our most staunch globalists in markets like China, South Korea, and the United States, very nationalistic markets, markets that have big export cultures. We have over-indexed armchair globalists in markets like Brazil, Mexico, the Philippines, emerging markets. And then we sort of have these extreme globalists sort of over-indexing in sort of northern European markets. People do tend to travel a lot. We live in islands, mostly, have to get out of those small island cultures. So for all of those segments, there are particular ideas that might work especially well. And we wanted to think about these globalists. Are globalists who are particularly excited about the possibilities that global mobility offers them? So here's an idea from McCann London, a really great idea about how you might be able to sort of offer a meaningful role, play a meaningful role in the lives of these globalists.
Momondo.com helps people to find the best flights. We were asked to engage people in Momondo's flight search app with an idea that would travel. Travel is the second most talked about event we like to share with our friends. Friends that we now have all over the world. But what are friends if you never see them? Meet Friend Compass. Turn your smartphone into a compass to see where your friends live around the world and the cheapest flights to visit them. Friend Compass uses your phone's GPS location, the Facebook API, and Momondo's search engine to instantly find the best flights to visit each of your friends. Sort your friends in the flight search by price, distance, and weather. Discover and share highlights about your friends, such as your cheapest and farthest friend to visit, and book a flight with a few taps, or send your friends a heads up. Friend Compass challenged traditional flight search with its new, fun, social dimension. It was quickly shared worldwide via profile pages, news feeds, links, and blogs. The Friend Compass campaign inspired traveling worldwide simply by using friendships, turning this, this, and this into destinations. And the result? Friend Compass generated almost 13 million media impressions in the first week of launch. It has transformed Momondo's business, as instead of people just searching a few flights at a time, they now search flights to each of their friends on Facebook, which on average is more than 250 people, or more than 1,000% increase in searches generated for Momondo per user. In the end, it's not where you want to go, it's who you want to visit.
About thinking about that power of connection, and the reason why we travel is really about the people that we visit rather than the places that we go. So that's a brief overview of our Calibrator in terms of thinking about how you might navigate globality. As I mentioned, there are many ways that we can sort of dial up, dial down, think about each of those five categories across our Calibrator. But ultimately, we want to find where freedom exists within your organization and the business model that you are currently using. Next, our second principle is about earning our way into culture. Earning our way into culture is really about understanding the what, the where, and the how of people's lives, and really thinking about this in a deep, savvy way. So in the course of our research, we asked a whole series of value statements, truth statements is what we call them, and through those truth statements, we distilled down five fundamental human truths that we share universally. Of course, social scientists like Maslow and Hofstede have all come up with these kinds of models, but these human truths we believe are the truths that drive business today. And so these are what unite us: connection, success, love, discovery, and purpose. Another map to PC complication. They don't have much love for each other, do they? Those two technical systems. Anyways, so a couple of statements. I just want to share with you some of those examples of truth statements. We asked people if it was more important to be creative and take risks than to be pragmatic and remain secure. That is really highly believed in Colombia, of all places. 65% believe it's more important to be creative. And then when we look at a market, this question about technological innovation making the world better, we see that across Europe, Russians are most excited about technological innovations and their potential to make the world better. Of course, each of those values, those truth values, whether it's purpose, discovery, love, they all play out differently in each market that we go to. And when we think about how they play out differently, it's a difference in terms of the characteristics or traits that mark you, the ways that you are in the world, or the places or the settings where you express love or connection, the things that you might have to demonstrate success or discovery, or the things that you do to display or your commitment to love or purpose. Brands can really tap into these for their own success. So I'm taking a very simple model, showing you how MasterCard, in understanding that experiences are more important than things, which is really a connections truth, really understood that this connections truth plays out differently from market to market. So in this print campaign for Priceless Cities, they looked at Paris. You see this sort of image. It's very stereotypical French. It's characteristic cliché, Jean-Luc Godard. It's sensual, it's dangerous, it's sort of black and white, it's very artful. But then you look at this example from New York. It's paternal, it's father and son, it's baseball, it's celebratory, it's winning, it's the Statue of Liberty. It's everything that you sort of think might matter to an American, and that connection's true. Or you think about Lima. Lima, this is a very different look at connections. I don't know if you read Spanish, anyone, but this is really about feeling a connection with the earth and your history and heritage. Really a noble, sort of long-term, primordial connections truth. So now we have the what, those five human truths. Now to the where. And I want to very quickly expose you to sort of thinking about the social media landscape through a cultural lens, rather than just a usage, frequency, or penetration lens. So here we've developed this digital solar system. Very quickly, that central orbit is the size of the online population. And then each of the planets are going to be represented in terms of their unique daily users. So let's look at Germany. Germany has a huge online population, but a very tiny Twitter population. It's almost non-existent. Why does that take place? Two reasons. Germans are particularly risk-averse in social media culture, but also the German language, it's almost impossible to communicate in anything in under than 144 characters. Now when we look at France, France has a really large online population, but nearly all of those social media channels under-index compared to the global averages. Really a culture which prefers offline communications rather than online connections. And then when we look at Romania, smaller online population, the emergence of a particularly local model, a local social platform, which is really about using content, really, and then this massive Facebook, Facebook subscription. Really interesting difference there. I think we'll talk a little bit more about that in the panel. So now that we have a set of tools to navigate cultural differences, the sort of what and the where, what is the how? How do we communicate? How do we earn our way into people's lives? And I think we really took a great lesson from one of our respondents in Japan, who told us, the entering culture should not overtake the existing values. There needs to be a way to coexist while being able to learn the interesting parts from one another. That's really thinking about brands having an additive role rather than simply a corrective or a rehabilitative or a liberating role. It's an additive role. So one of the simple ways to think about that is just changing the basic question that we ask. Rather than asking, does this work in the UK or is this going to work in the UK, we can ask, does this work for the UK? That shifts us into thinking about the ways in which we might enrich people's lives. And I'm going to show you an example of a brand that really thinks through its brand ecosystem, has a strong mission, and that mission plays out across every touch point in its system. But not only that, it has chosen to extend its mission into a new touch point that doesn't necessarily belong to its ecosystem, but one that they can own very clearly based upon that commitment to its purpose.
Nearly every day something almost happens. You've kind of got to be able to second guess the taxi in front of you or the pedestrians coming up.
I end up getting nearly hit at least once a day.
The young driver lost concentration and hit me from behind. I was extremely lucky that day. The doctor said that 95% of people that would have sustained those injuries would have been killed by them.
All roads that were built really 100 years ago for far less traffic.
In terms of cycling at night, I feel way less visible. Sometimes I choose not to cycle home at night. It's a lot more dangerous.
That's the good thing about life, mate, because it makes it very hard for you to be missed.
putting something on that will make you scream out at friends like me is a fantastic thing.
I think cycle safety in London is not all about bicycles. It's about cars, it's about pedestrians, it's about sharing the road with other users. So it's great that a car brand has got involved to essentially help cyclists, help drivers in the end, save lives.
So this wasn't just a PR stunt. This is actually available in bike shops across London and the UK. But what I love about this is the fact that that mission, that commitment to safety, has extended outward into bicycle safety, and it's really a localized understanding of context, the sort of danger and threat of the streets of London. So our next principle is about inspiring creative travels, and this is going to be very brief. Our panel is going to pick up on this topic at length. But very quickly, we've been tracking cultural waves, and I think many of you probably have. But what's really interesting about the cultural waves is in the ways in which something like soap operas, Latino telenovelas emerging from Mexico and Colombia sort of track their way into the Middle East. And in the Middle East, they're translated and dubbed into Arabic. And these become models for local beauty standards. I really think that those influences and those sort of trans-regional influences are important to track, whether it's the Korean Wave, which is being sponsored by the Korean government. The Korean government is funding the translation of Korean dramas and translating those into Spanish so they can penetrate Latin America, or the fact that a third of Bollywood's revenues come from North America. Really interesting power of these cultural waves. Thinking about the ways in which brands might be able to harness or learn from those cultural formats. Of course, in Europe, there are particular lines of influence. These are all the primary lines of influence that our European respondents see. You see that the UK is the most influential cultural market in the region, with France coming in at its close second. But secondary lines of influence are even more interesting. You see that countries like Italy and Germany play a role. So there's this really bi-directional dynamic in the way in which cultural orders are being transformed. Of course, you know, all that complexity is sort of boiled down into thinking about how you might create universal sparks that spark universal reactions. And then what we really think is important here is to ask yourself some very simple questions, above and beyond all that complexity of influence and sort of the attraction across regions. The first is, when you're thinking, if you're in the business of connection, asking yourself the question, is this going to help someone feel closer to the things or the people that they feel intimate with? Or if it's about love, is this really going to inspire passion or love or romance? Is that something that you're going to be able to engender? When if you're in the business of discovery, are you going to be able to create awe or awareness or the excitement of a quest? Are you in the business of purpose? Will you be able to help somebody feel as though they achieve something or feel like they're part of something bigger? And lastly, will you help somebody when it comes to success accomplish something, something more meaningful than just product? So now we have an operating framework for how global or local we are, a set of behaviors, and a view on ideas of brands and travel. Ultimately, we have this principle, again, deep globality. That's, again, thinking about enrichment, thinking about multi-market capacity, thinking about the ways in which you can get your ideas or brands or movements to travel. Those are the three principles. And lastly, I have one final thought to share with you. As I mentioned, we conducted interviews with CMOs and thought leaders across media and industry, and we asked them some of their thoughts about innovation. So I'm going to share a brief reel of some of those thoughts and ideas, thought starters about innovation, and then we're going to take it over to the panel.
I think ultimately it's very difficult to stop this pace of innovation, especially because it's innovation that is almost like untamable, right? It's like water or a river that has sort of run over its edges, and it's just going to go where the water is going to go.
We have access now to a global brain. There is a global brain that is measured in milliseconds now. And That's just a tremendous time to be able to live and look at any problem.
One thing we've tried to do here at the Coca-Cola Company is build what I call the network organizational model. A network organization has no center. It has hubs and nodes of expertise. It's a learning organization. It's an organization where you can move wisdom, learning, knowledge out to the fringes of the far hinders of your organization faster than a competitor. You can be an advantage.
Well, no, one thing that I think that a lot of people, especially sort of in thinking about change and embracing change and bringing change into an organization, sometimes tend to feel somewhat overwhelmed or feel like, yeah, I know I need to, but where do I even begin? And what I've learned over the years is that the best way to do it is to just do it.
I also think that fires can happen on a more viral nature, where things are a little spark in some far corner of the world can ignite something that goes crazy. So I don't believe that one is necessarily better. I believe that if I'm going to bet on a horse, I'm going to bet on the entity that can propel that message further and faster and louder.
I think originally everybody just thought, I'll take my 30-second film and I'll use that on mobile devices. And no, that doesn't work. And you know, you've got to have device-relevant content. And so managing that ecosystem, sourcing that ecosystem, curating that ecosystem, bringing that into the black box, I mean, getting it all and then distributing that is not going to be easy for marketers. We don't want to deliver to the market 100% of the solution, because then you stifle the creativity of the locals. Just this year, 175 countries took our World Cup toolkit, and we thought we saved $25 million. So these are massive amounts of productivity savings for the company. But they all still allow the localization.
All right, thank you very much. We're going to turn over to the panel now. Leave so many ideas and principles on the table. What to you was perhaps
the most striking piece of what you say? Let's start with you.
Complex, amplu, e greu de spus. E un studiu interesant. Ce îmi place este recomandarea de la final și nu cred, iarăși, cred că această recomandare se aplică numai între, ci în general, cât administrației, cât și statului și guvernului. O să vorbesc, și recomandarea asta de la final este să ai întotdeauna grijă cărei audiențe te adresezi. Pentru că altfel mesajul tău se pierde pe parcurs.
So the importance of timing and targeting. You know, especially because I think the most interesting thing that I loved from Claudia's presentation is it just drove the point home, didn't it, for all you guys as well, that everything that's local becomes instantly global. So you don't have the time to kind of just let something happen in a small little place somewhere. Twitter starts revolutions because, boom, it goes global very, very quickly. So I think you're absolutely right. We have to become so careful in the way we pick the audiences and pick and curate messages that we want them to then socialize. So you don't need media to do that anymore. What about you, Anna? What did you find?
To add on what Claudio said, I think timing is extremely important. And I will go back a little bit to his presentation from the beginning related to what happened in Romania lately. So you can imagine a global brand that has a global campaign that has actually to stop because of decency, because of empathy, because you need to stop and, you know, not continue with your life while a country in which you operate goes through the tragedy that goes. So I think this is what we faced in Romania lately, a lot of decency from most of the global brands that for a week or so, they just completely stopped their communication and their campaigns because they felt empathy with the victims of the tragedy in Romania. So I think time is very, very important besides context and audience when you address your message and when you coordinate your campaigns or you are, you know, into communicating something. So I think that was also a finding in the research, which is extremely valid to all global brands, no matter the market in which you operate in.
Well, the importance of timing should not be undermined. I think it's very artful, isn't it, in this world to know when to shut up, when to not say something. It's just as important. I think that you don't have a constant or uniform group of and then what about you, as in your creative person, what did you see here that made you think, oh, I kind of like that, you would walk away from here and say, I heard that, that was interesting, what did you say?
Actually, everything was very interesting. That everything was great, so I would, yeah, this would be like stories with my friends for like, I don't know, months now.
Yeah.
No, so for me what was very interesting and also was like finally, so the IKEA example. So I think a lot of people that are global still think they're local and they're acting a bit local. So even though it's going on for a while, I think people are still struggling to make the most of the globalization, okay? So I think they're still falling in some traps, okay, of thinking that they are local and not having like the full picture. I think there are a lot of opportunities out there. A lot of brands are struggling and I think a big creative opportunity is creating utility. Utility for a brand, okay? And I think that's a very good opportunity to export to this creativity. So to take a local utility that the brand created and export it abroad, export it worldwide. You know, so I think this globalization comes with risks and also with opportunities. I think everybody is still struggling a bit to make a, to try to avoid the traps and make the most of the opportunity. So I think in the next years, probably we're going to see a lot more of the making the most of the opportunities and hopefully a lot less of the traps of the devices.
Yeah, it's
always better.
Diana, last but not least, we'll start the next one with her.
No, please don't.
You know, I mean, it's so interesting because we are so connected professionally based on what we do because of the planners that, you know, it's been our nature to question everything. And I'm quite interested, you know, in this forum, obviously, in the agency, you see this, you see this in Miami with us, you see this in London with us, you see this in three other countries. How do you feel about today? And how do you feel about the context of innovation? And what about this between the world of interesting?
Well, it's almost like a tough question, Harjo. But I think as I was listening to the results, I was actually wondering and I was curious what the impact would be listening to it in Romania after I've done it in Miami and in London. And somehow what I still feel is very relevant, and Claudio also helped a lot with the contextualization, is that I believe at the importance of having a cultural meaning of your brand and doing something that is additive for the culture is as relevant in here as anywhere else in the world, if not even more relevant. Because I think people in here as well have tremendous expectations from brands. I mean, everybody today kind of knows something about the expected quality or the functionalities of products and the brands behind. But I think there are a lot of expectations from people, from brands to bring meaning, to bring something that they can relate to, that can inspire them, you know. There was this thing that if you want to know culture, listen to the stories, and if you want to change culture, change the stories. And I think people, especially today in Romania, are waiting and expecting for stories that are new, inspiring, meaningful, that give them the power to create that change that Claudio was mentioning. And I think brands have a tremendous opportunity to do that in here, if that makes sense.
Well, absolutely. Do you think,
absolutely. I think it's about engaging them in the story. I think it's about creating agility at times, like Adeline is saying. And yeah, also use some of the local elements of culture, but bring them to a story that can have universal or global meaning, you know, because that's going to make them feel part of the bigger world.
And I think if you just think about it, as you know, marketing is cool. I can't help but think that sounds like, yeah, of course we should do that. But of course that's hard, it's not easy, because what basically comes down to is you giving up some level of control and saying, okay, I'm going to kind of open up the conversation. I'm not going to lead the conversation, but you're going to be part of it. So it's about giving up some level of control, and that cannot be easy for a marketer. But I'm going to be here with us as a marketer. You've got this reputation of being really radical, different, more of it. Champion for creative thinking in this market. How do you feel about helping brands and marketers become more courageous about giving up this control? Because it's not going to happen if marketers keep control.
The point is that you have no choice. I mean, we are living in a world where basically if you are not there, you are there anyway because they talk about you. So it's when you engage them and you come towards them, it's also, you know, a way of showing them that you care. You care about their opinion, you care about what they say about you, what they think about you, and you involve them into your life. Because they are involved anyway. They are going to pick up stories and talk about you over there anyway. And it's not a matter of control, but I think it's more about directing the conversation into an area where it's okay for you and it's also okay for your consumers. But I think, yes, it's extremely important that if you are not courageous and if you are not out there completely different and you are not trying to challenge the status quo, you are gonna die at the end of the day. So I don't think you are gonna survive because the dynamics in this world are so happening so fast that if you are not keeping up, you know, and you don't learn to run with the same speed as a brand, you're not going to survive.
Yeah, it's really not an option.
I think there is not an option for quite some time. And if brands didn't understood that, I'm sorry for that.
Right. Well, Claudio, in your role as a journalist, what do you think? Because, you know, the stories that people socialize become new stories, right? That's the problem. Then there are people like you who are at the front line of making the stories that get socialized become become even more important or seminal in creating change, or forever, you know, getting people to observe it as something that needs to, we need to stop and take notice of that. How do you decide as a journalist? Because I can't help but think, journalism, on the one hand, you have to be objective. On the other hand, all stories are true, because they're coming up all the time. To Anka's point, people are talking all the time. How do you as a journalist decide which stories deserve to be elevated and which don't?
Există, vorbesc la urmă, răspunsul întâi și urmă o mică paranteză. Răspunsul ar fi așa, foarte scurt. Avem un principiu și nu e aceeași sau aceeași putere pe care le au cei care lucrează în parte de față. Trebuie să te alături conversației, dar trebuie să fii relevant și să alegi subiectul relevant de conversație. Cum o faci? E secretul și pe baza background-ului jurnalistic poți face alegerile corecte. Marea dilemă este în acest moment legată de rolul fundamental al jurnalistului și al jurnalistului. Jurnalistul trebuie să relateze în principal niște fapte. Problema jurnalistului sau jurnalistului este că dacă încercează să mai fie relevant ca transmițător, ca emițător al mesajului, el va fi imediat și instantaneu ocolit de căi directe de comunicare. Poți să ai o unealtă de a transmite un mesaj, definesc unealta, spre exemplu, televiziune, un mic ecran, o cameră și să ai un reach extrem de mare. Vei deveni irelevant și vei fi ocolit rapid de câteva postări puse pe Facebook, dacă tu nu ai ceea ce cere acest job de jurnalist și anume credibilitate. Dacă tu nu ești un transmițător credibil, vei fi imediat ocolit ca transmițător al mesajului. Pentru că în momentul ăsta, oricine poate să fie un emițător, transmițător, purtător de mesaj. Cea de-a doua parte a parantezei, continui discuția precedentă, e legată de nu pricep la marketing. Mă uit cu atenție, îmi place, nu pricep nici la advertising, dar mă uit cu atenție și îmi place industria asta. Un exemplu legat de faptul că nu totdeauna, dacă știi în principiu ce trebuie să faci, și anume să te alături conversației, să intri în discuție cu oamenii, să ceri pe tine, reușești. Și greșeala principală este că nu știi cum să o faci. Acest tip de comunicare trebuie să aibă în spate oameni care înțeleg cum funcționează sistemul și prevăd niște posibile răspunsuri. Cunosc un brand internațional care s-a gândit să comunice, să fie interactiv pe social media. Și a făcut următoarea chestiune. Așa, simplistă. Și-au dat seama că în fiecare zi a anului există câte o zi internațională, sunt multe zile în care sunt chiar mai multe zile internaționale. Brandul respectiv, în fiecare zi, dă un mesaj prin care salută Ziua Internațională a Libertății de Opinie. Extrem de frumos, plăcut, unii oameni, da, într-adevăr, participă. Nu vreau să vă povestesc cum s-au descurcat când, da, există și așa ceva, urma Ziua Internațională a Toaletei. Sau a căzii de baie. Nu vreau să vă spun, nu o să vă spun. Au încercat să ocolească toaleta și cadă de baie, oricum n-avea nicio legătură cu ceea ce evideau sau produceau. Însă, dacă nu știi la ce să te aștepți atunci când plănuiești un astfel de tip de comunicare, vei greși. Mai bine nu o faci și mor onorabil. Sau, și mai bine, angajează pe cineva care se pricepe.
That's great. Thank you very much. I followed 99% of that. I think it's great. Two things I learned from that I think all of us in the business of brand, marketing, innovation, which is exactly what makes it useful for people in new and different ways, have to understand from that is you can't just sit there and witness a conversation. You have to enable it. You have to enable it in a meaningful way because you are accountable for conversation back to innovation, because it is, after all, the larger theme of the day. So there's a couple of things that came up. I think I want to talk very briefly about the three principles, and we'll just kind of do one question on each. We've got just enough time to cover that. But I think it would be interesting to just get a perspective from three different points of origin, people approach the problem from different points of view. Innovation, really, if it is about kind of creating some meaningful change, and you look at the category, and I think one thing we learned from the category piece was, one, know what is the benefit of being global or local in the market that you are in and for the market that you want to be in. So at what point does it help to be, let's say, Romanian, and at what point do you want to be less Romanian and borrow more from another province, is one way of looking at it. The other thing I want to talk about is, and we'll come to that later, because I think that directly impacts the way the product, because that means it's a product-driven. I think before that, I want to talk to Becca about something. This, again, she's in the marketing business. There are so many great innovative brands and companies out there, and I think one thing that's common is, like, look at Virgin, for example. Do we agree that they innovate? Yeah? And I think one observation that we have is, they innovate categories, because what they do is, they take principles from categories that are traditionally not associated with the category that they want to innovate. For example, what does record and music have to teach airlines, and what can hotels learn from airlines, and what can gyms learn from the travel companies and things like that. So I think what they do is they hijack everything and they borrow from different categories and see what can you appropriate from a category that's different from the one you operate in. How important is meaningful or interesting is that approach to the market? Because when you think about the business that you're in, financial services, what categories are an inspiration to you?
Well, easily is to say that service categories. But I think in our world and in the world in which we live right now, when, for example, financial payments are going beyond the banking industry, I think telecom is a real inspiration for banking and finance industry, because telecom is trying to innovate in this direction and trying to create payment solutions via the mobile phone and via different kind of instruments that are trying to consume less and less time from the time of the consumer. So I think this could be, banks can learn a lot from how telecom approaches this. I think also from the CSR area, foundations, and what stays at the basis of a foundation, of an NGO, banks can learn a lot as well, because it's about responsibility, it's about education, it's about social responsibility, it's about addressing some categories that are in need, and where a bank can contribute a lot, because the banks are seen as the engine of the economy. And although in the last years we've been, addressed with a lot of, not very nice words, and we have this problem of reputation, we have to admit that without banks, an economy of a country cannot survive. We did our mistakes, we did our paybacks for those mistakes, but I think banks are very, very important in educating in a healthier direction the population in terms of savings, in terms of consumption. We've learned a lot from the history mistakes of how this turned to against us and against our customers. I think from FMCG, to understand the consumer better. For example, I'm a very big fan of the service brands that are trying to reach to their consumers differently. Like, for example, if you go to a fast food chain, I'm not going to give names right now, but they are going to ask you all the time, do you want maybe a different type of size of French fries, or a bigger Coke, or a bigger Pepsi, or whatever? We don't have this type of thinking into our sales force. They normally receive very, very specific products, and they just go there with those products. We need to learn from FMCG to understand better the consumer needs and start creating our products from the needs of the consumer, not vice versa. Normally, the banking industry sits into an office and say, okay, we need credit cards. What a credit card does? We never thought, why would a person need a credit card? And how to make that credit card to fit the need of that consumer. So right now we are stepping back and we are doing this as a bank as well. For example, we completely recreated our website from the needs point of view. I'm not selling consumer loans there. I'm just trying to create a conversation towards I need a car, I need a house, I need a vacation, I need education. And then matching those products towards those needs. So I think a rethinking of our business model is necessary, and there are a lot of industries from which we can absorb from information and also experience.
So that's one part, like you actually design your offering in an innovative way by looking outside the category that you operate in and see what out of there might apply to you, how can you hack it, so to speak, right?
Yeah, and when I talk about innovation, I'm not talking about reinventing the wheel. I'm talking about, you know, putting your imprint towards something that is really addressing your industry, your problems, your, I don't know, potential threats of the industry. And not to forget that we are an industry that is very, very regulated, and it's regulated differently in different countries. So you have to address that as well and take care of what's going on in your country and what are the rules and the laws in your country.
One question to you before we move to the next one is, to close the loop on this, who do you think is doing this well?
You mean like an industry or
a in your category? Like, if you would say, who do you think is doing this well? Is there anyone that you say, you know what, they're innovative, they're doing this well, and they borrow from other categories most meaningfully and redesign the market in most meaningful ways? Can you just be similar examples from
them? I think I'm going to give an example, and I'm pretty sure none have, you know, anyone did this before, but I'm going to give an example of our competitors, which I admire very much. For example, Banca Transilvania. I think they addressed a niche from the very beginning, which is the entrepreneur niche, and they did their best to address that niche in the best possible way. I think ING innovated a lot in Romania with payments and mobile payments and out-of-home banking. So I think we have a lot of examples also in Romania of banks that try to, you know, address the status quo of the banking industry of being known as a rigid and, you know, stiff industry that is not open to innovation. And what they did is that they tried to innovate in their category and either choose a niche or a specific target that they tried to address completely different. So we have a lot of universal banks everywhere in this world, especially in Romania. I think what the future will bring in our industry is a little bit of specialization in different areas. Because we cannot have all universal banks. We need to have banks that are addressing specific needs, specific targets, because we don't talk about the same, you know, target categories like years ago. We have sub-segments that are addressing, you know, that need different addressing.
So we got a little bit of perspective on how you're dealing with your client. Let's talk about how we bring that to life externally. So, Caitlin, you've got a great track record in doing category busting work. I mean, that's your location. You take categories that are known to do things a certain way, and then you do something really surprising with them. So, as a creative person with that kind of a track record, what do you think is the basis for innovation in creativity? Do you think looking outside the category is a fair strategy? Is that one of your ways to tell someone, don't look like a bank, don't talk like a bank, because when you say, but just because you are this, doesn't mean you have to look like that. What's your point of view on where you look for inspiration?
I think always it's good to find references outside the category. I always tell my creatives that it's, for advertising people, creative people, it's really, really easy to get stuck in an advertising bubble. So basically what happens is your friends are also from advertising agencies or marketeers or artists. So what you do, you talk about advertising all the time. So you get stuck in this advertising bubble, you know. So all your ideas would be about advertising or related to an another campaign, or you have like benchmarks only from advertising. And I think that's very dangerous because it limits you very much. So you always need to reach out to other industries, because I mean, for me, I think we have a lot of competition in terms of creativity from other industries. And look at music. I think a lot of artists are doing now so much better creative work that advertising agencies are doing. And look at even in Cannes. I mean, some Grand Prix winners don't come from advertising agencies. And this gives us a signal that creativity comes a lot from other fields. So we need to look at that, and we need to find benchmarks outside advertising, because that's the only way we can innovate and come up with like really, really fresh ideas. And when it comes to clients, yeah, I mean, you can go to them. I don't believe in telling them to be different just for the sake of being different. But I think always innovation comes from a need, okay? So if you pinpoint a certain need that might find some relevance in other fields and find inspiration in those other fields on how to address it, I think that's very good. And also, I think it's a great opportunity when it comes to globalization and innovation, because creatives always want to come up with big ideas. This is what they talk about. Let's come up with big ideas, innovation, something new. And I think the best way of having innovation in a global manner, it's exporting this stuff. Okay, so when you come up with something really new, it's really easier now to make it travel. Look at Uber. Think about Uber now. What would Uber be if you had it only in one country? Right. You know? I mean, you were really happy when you came in Bucharest and you were searching for a cab. You could have used that. So that's like a great idea which became brilliant only because it's now global. Okay, so I think that's a great opportunity.
So they looked outside their country, yeah. Obviously, they looked at that. Now, one question to you before we move to Diana and close the conversation. Where does Romania look for inspiration? Or where do you think, where does Romania draw influence from, and what does Romania influence? Because when we saw this little map, well, there are secondary and primary lines of influence. So, I know it's a contentious subject, but who does?
I think at some point, Romania was looking at the West. It was like very aspirational. Everything that happened in the West was like, we need to go there, we need to beat that, and we also need to beat that, you know? So we're very ambitious, and I think for a long time we were trying to find inspiration there. I think now things have changed a bit, and I think Romanians are starting, because you're talking about reaching out to other fields, I think now Romanians are starting to find inspirations also in Romania, you know, but reaching out to other fields and trying to put some pieces together and to create, I don't know, something new. Also, I mean, you cannot say everybody's always looking at great ideas, but I don't think now, I think people are starting to get away, because we've been looking up to the West for such a long time, and I think now people are starting to, I don't know, reach out their perspective, and they're starting to think that if you only look to one place for references, it's not good, and this is not good enough. So I think they're very open to any good idea from all around the world, from anywhere.
So
yeah.
There wouldn't be like one dotted line
on that map? No, not really. And I think that's a very good thing. That's a very good thing, because it's very diverse now.
Yeah.
So yeah, I think they're very open. I think one of the main features and one of the main advantages that we have in this moment is that we're very curious, and I think we're very open. Yeah, so that calls for a change, and this is what people are asking for on the street. Everybody is asking for a change.
And curiosity and openness is obviously important for being innovative. Last question, Diana. I know we're out of time, but I really don't think it would be a wise thing on our part to kind of make such an important piece of this puzzle. As a strategy head of Valley, in this extremely diverse, vibrant, rich market that makes so much beautiful work, you clearly help clients and brands understand where they should look to be able to meaningfully extend themselves or present themselves in an innovative manner or to create an innovation. One thing that the study throws up for us is that people are united and divided by the same human values. And how do you think that helps? Do you think that that is comforting to know, so you can actually tell a client and say, no, you're in the business connection. What if you were in this business? What if you were in this business? Do you think that's help? That's a helpful process?
I think that one of the approaches that we're refining time and that led to how we look and how we create meaningful brands together with our clients is that we are actually, we challenge stuff. Like when we want to look at what we can, how we can create a brand idea, the first thing we do is to try to understand the conversations that people are having. And the conversations not just related to that brand, not just related to that category, but the conversations that are related to their lives and their point in their lives. And that is most of the time influenced by factors that have nothing to do with advertising or have nothing to do with your category whatsoever. Most of the time it's just what happens because of accumulation of social and economic factors that are driving you, you know, to keep you awake at night. Thinking about some stuff. So the first thing that we do is to try to understand what the conversation is. Once we understand what the conversation is, then the next thing we do is just challenge. I mean, we literally, I mean, we're applying a bit of intelligent naivety in here and asking, what if we didn't look at what the category is doing, but rather come up with something that is tapping this new behavior that we're noticing and that everybody seems to be appealing to. And I think it is this challenger mentality that helps us create a lot of innovation, and it also has to do a lot with the Romanian heritage, connected to what Catalina was saying earlier. I mean, Romania as a nation has a history of scarcity, you know, we always lack resources, we lack money, we lack, you know, but we never lacked ambition. I mean, we always wanted to be like the best, but we always had resources like the not so best. So we are always forced to come up with lateral solutions and inventive solutions and new ways of looking at things, which obviously sometimes were, you know, funny shortcuts, but most of the times can also be looked at as really impactful ideas that can easily travel. And this is why Montan Bucharest is interested in Trifobal Global Brands and stuff.
That's great. So we're out of time. This is a great conversation. Before we end, everyone, one word, only so that I think it's because I love doing this experiment in panels, because you never know what you get. And panelists hate it. But we're going to do this. In one word, tell me, in your work, in based on your impression today, what is innovation to you? One word.
Okay,
creativity. I got that.
Courage.
Courage.
Challenge.
Challenge, yes.
Oh, you just didn't have a microphone.
Challenge, yeah.
You were just giving yourself some
extra. I bought some time. I don't know, I think it's change. Because it's like related to the point, so I would pick change.
Yes.
I think we're trained.
And it's no secret that we're good down to four C's. So we have courage, creativity, challenge, and change. So those are the cornerstones of what we've talked about today, what we've seen in this study. And in order to make any of this real and meaningful, I think exactly as our panelists said in the study, you need to have the courage to change things, you need to be able to see the challenge and the benefit of that, and you need to have the creativity and to make that change actually meaningful and a change that people look forward to. Thank you so much for your time, guys. Thank you for listening.
Thank you again for being here. Because thank you for being on time. Sper că v-a plăcut. Or mai rămâne cine are întrebări, vă rog, cine vrea să duce fără întrebări. O să vă intrăm la o pauză bine meditată. Ne așteaptă o sesiune importantă și vreau să veniți pregătiți. Și vreau doar să vă amintesc, pentru cine nu a văzut aici în hol alături de noi, este Staru Pramen. Dacă sunteți pe doi sau pe de doi, dacă băiat, fete și băieți, venea la asta rugarea să vedește doar în doi, ca să știți. Pauză. Mulțumesc frumos.